سورة الفاتحة. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، بارئ الخلائق أجمعين، فاطر السماوات والأرضين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، المبعوث رحمة للعالمين، شفيع المذنبين وحبيب قلوب الصادقين، سيدنا ومولانا أبي القاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الأطيبين الأطهرين الهداة المهديين، ولعنة الله على أعدائهم إلى قيام يوم الدين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أما بعد، فقد قال الله عز وجل: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قد خلت من قبلكم سنن فسيروا في الأرض فانظروا كيف كان عاقبة المكذبين. هذا بيان للناس وهدى وموعظة للمتقين. صلوات.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
Dear brothers and sisters, over the last several nights we have talked about the conduct and the practice and the principles that Allah uses to govern the affairs of creation. And within creation there are the affairs of all that exists within the world, whether it be human affairs or the affairs of animals and plants and even those things that we think of as being inanimate objects. All of them are governed by certain practices and by certain principles. And for this reason, from an Islamic perspective, because nothing is outside of the power and the control of Allah, there is nothing that is a secular sphere. There is nothing that is outside of our religious concern. But to understand whether something can have a meaning for our spiritual development or not, it is important for us to appreciate the role of the intention, the niyyah. We say that everything within the universe exists according to principles that Allah has put in place. That doesn't mean that those affairs will run the same way for all people. It doesn't mean that those affairs will be governed equally, regardless of the input that comes from a human being. To illustrate that point, let us return to a question that we asked in the earlier presentations. And this is, why would Allah punish somebody in the hereafter? If we think of punishment, we think of it as being either an example for other people, a deterrent for others, or a deterrent for the criminal. Or we think of it as a means of giving some closure and satisfaction to people who may have been wronged or victimized by a crime. Now, we responded to this question by saying that in the eyes of Allah, there are different levels of a compensation for an action that a person may do. There are worldly, there are outwardly, and there are inner effects for our actions. And the effect that we see in the hereafter is in reality the coming to fruition of the reality of what we have done in this world. It is not something that comes from the outside. To understand this more fully and to appreciate the importance of the intention, let us divide up the consequences of actions into three different stages. One type of consequence is a legal or a legislated consequence. If I do something, then there will be a result of my action on a legal level. And that can be a just law or it can be an unjust law. It can be a law that has been created by a human being, or it can be a law that has been revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But regardless of whether the law is from Allah or from a human being, regardless of whether it is fair or whether it is unfair, what are the consequences of laws within society? They regulate human affairs. There is a basis on which a particular consequence is legislated, and if those conditions are fulfilled, then there might be a reward or there might be a punishment. In our secular law, we have civil and we have criminal cases. Each of them has their process, each of them has their consequences. Within Islam, we also have laws, and there are rewards or there are punishments, there are different consequences for different actions. That is within this world. In some cases, that consequence depends on the intention, and in other cases, the consequence does not depend on the intention. It's just a matter of what conditions have been put in the legislation. For example, the rules of purity and impurity, they don't depend on intention. If there is blood that has come on my clothing, I cannot pray with that clothing without either washing or changing my clothes. It doesn't matter whether there was an intention to get my clothes dirty or whether there was no intention. Najasat has a particular effect. There is a consequence for it, and it has to be either removed or it has to be washed in order for me to be able to pray. For me to require the repetition of my tahara or my wudu, if I fall asleep, whether I plan and I take sleeping pills and I deliberately fall asleep, or whether I inadvertently happen to fall asleep while I wanted to do something else, my state of purity or tahara is broken. And so that law, that consequence, does not depend on deliberation or intentionality. It is a legal consequence. In other cases, the legal consequence, in this case we're talking about in Islamic law, will depend on my intention. So take those same two examples. My clothing is impure, and I deliberately go and I wash it. It becomes pure. If I don't intend to wash it, but I am carrying that clothing somewhere, maybe to put it in a laundry basket, and inadvertently it happens to get wet and it happens to get washed. Maybe I go outside, it is raining very heavily, or it falls from my hand into a pool of water and I pick it up and that impurity has been washed. There was no intention, but the impurity is removed and the consequence is now different. But when it comes to wudu, the breaking of wudu does not depend on my intention. But for me to do wudu, I can't inadvertently or forgetfully do the actions and say that, well, now I have purified myself. I can't say that wudu requires me to wash just certain parts of my body, my face, my two hands, and wipe my head and wipe my feet. So rather than do that limited act, I can take a shower and I will be much more clean than I would have been if I had just done wudu. And therefore I should have that much more readiness to pray. It depends on a certain process and it depends on a certain intention. If I don't have the intention, those actions will not result in a state of purity. And if I do more, even with the intention, but it doesn't follow the process and the rules, it will not result in a state of purity. So one stage of human affairs is governed by those laws that have a result. And the purpose of those laws is to govern our worldly affairs. In the hereafter, we don't have laws that are going to be in place where something will be permitted or something will be forbidden. That is not an area where we are going to be tested and our affairs are going to be regulated as they are in this world. There will be a manifestation of God's wisdom, but those laws, they are there because in this world, we need to know how to worship. We need to know how to interact with other people. We need to know how to be good stewards of creation. We need to know how to regulate our affairs in order to fulfill the obligation and the trust we have before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tahara is a very good thing. There are sins that are very evil. In the hereafter, in paradise, people will do that which is good, and they will abstain from that which is evil. But it will not be because certain things are obligations and certain things are forbidden. That type of interaction is exclusive to this world in order to regulate our affairs. So it's not regulating our affairs only for this world. That regulation will prepare us to be able to either achieve salvation or achieve a higher rank in paradise. When I say that it is for the affairs of this world, it means that it is limited to this world. That law, what is wajib, what is mustahab, what is mubah, what is makruh, what is haram, it will not apply in the hereafter. It will help me make or break my life in the hereafter, but that law will not apply in the hereafter. So this is one level of human obligations. The consequences of our actions in this world, positive or negative, they are determined by laws. With secular laws, they are man-made, and the consequences also are only for this world. With divine laws, they are to regulate our affairs in this world, but the consequences will extend to the hereafter. Now there are two other levels of consequences to our actions, and these are often confused. One is what is known in Arabic as al-athar al-takwiniyya, the creational or the existential consequences of our actions. And one is the manifestation of the reality of that action in the hereafter. These two are often confused, and people often have mistakes in their practice and in their priorities of their Islamic life, because they don't understand the difference between a consequence of an action on an existential level and the reality of that action on a spiritual level. So let me explain that difference, and then inshallah we will appreciate the value of the human intention in determining what our actions are worth. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. The creational or the existential result of an action is something that Allah has placed within existence from the moment that He created the world. When He created different objects, He created certain systems of cause and effect within creation. And the effects of those actions, they are present regardless of our desire, our intention, our knowledge, our ignorance. If we are ignorant, are we responsible for our ignorance or are we not responsible for our ignorance? The effect and the cause and effect system that exists within creation is independent of all of those different types of responses or those types of inputs that may exist from a human being. If I eat something that is damaging to my health, I might know what I am eating or I might not know what I am eating. I might have had the ability to find out or I might not have had the ability to find out. I may deliberately eat that food or I may not deliberately eat that food. But if it is harmful to my health, regardless of any of those inputs, regardless of any of those states of mind that I may have had, that harm will come within my body. That is the existential effect of that action. If a person thinks that something is water, but it actually is poison, if they drink that water, it may harm their body, it may damage some of their internal organs, or it may even cause their death. That effect is not because the person is sinful or is a criminal in having drunk that poison. They did not know, and maybe they had no way to know. But the worldly effect will still take place. That is one level of the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He has created certain effects within the system of the material world. Our job is to try to learn and to discover what those causes and those effects are, but it will always be a process. And that is not directly the concern of our religious teachings. It is our obligation as human beings, and Allah has given us the ability to learn and to study. But those same actions that exist within this world and have certain outward effects, they also have certain spiritual effects, and in that case, it entirely depends on what I had intended or what I had not intended. So when people say, why is it that there will be some who will have an eternal reward in the hereafter, and others who will have an eternal punishment in the hereafter, when in this world, those who did good only did good for a limited period of time. They didn't do good for an eternal life. And those who will be punished, they might have sinned maybe for 40 years, maybe for 50 years after they attained adulthood until the end of their life. Normally that is not more than a period of 50 or 60 years for an average person. The beginning of our life, we are not responsible for our actions, and in many cases at the end of our life also, we don't have that system or that ability to reason and to do what we want. So it's a limited period of time when we have the choice to do what we might want to do. When that question came to our sixth Imam, Imam Ja'far Sadiq alayhi salatu wa salam, he said that those people who did good did not do good with the intention that we're going to do good just for 40 years or 50 years. That was what they intended to do with their life, however long Allah will give them life. And those who did evil were planning on doing evil for as long as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them life. Their reward or their punishment is going to be based on their intention, not based on their outward action. So there is a difference between the creational effect and between the spiritual reality. A person who smokes, eventually they are going to damage their lungs and they might cause themselves to have various forms of illnesses. They may cause themselves to develop emphysema, they may cause themselves to develop various other health problems or complications, it might cause heart trouble or many other problems within their health. Now, does it make a difference whether you smoke one pack a day or five packs a day? Does it make a difference whether you smoke for 1 year or for 5 years? That is a creational effect of smoking. And therefore, that harm will develop based on the frequency and based on the duration of the action. But in the hereafter, if smoking is something that I know is damaging to my health, and I smoke knowing that it is something that is displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that it is a waste of my money, a waste of my resources, or that it will cause me to damage the life that Allah has given me. Does it matter whether I smoke one pack a day or five packs a day? Does it matter whether I smoke for 1 year or for 40 years? As to whether I will be rewarded or punished for my action based on the reality of that action. In the hereafter, it does not matter what the duration was. It matters what the intention was and what the culpability was of the person who did that action. And so a person who smokes once may be punishable in the hereafter if they did so knowing that they are squandering a resource and a trust that Allah has placed at their disposal, even if there is no physical harm that is done to their body. Another person may have begun smoking in a time when those physical harms were not visible. They did not know about it. And they will damage their body, and they may even end up causing their own death. But although they may have smoked for years, they will not be punished by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter, because they had no way of knowing medically and scientifically that this action was going to cause that level of harm. So there is a difference between al-athar al-takwiniyah, the existential and the creational effects, and between the otherworldly effects of our actions. The laws that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed are in view both of the outward worldly and material creational effects and in view of the spiritual effects in the hereafter. So when we look at Sharia and when we look at the laws that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed, one reason for those laws is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to live a life that is going to be for the best outcome of our physical health and our worldly relationships in view of the natural outcomes of our actions. The worldly material effects of our actions and the causes that we bring about through our actions. And also for the spiritual result that will come in the hereafter. Both of those are a concern of Islam. Out of the two, which is the primary concern of our Islamic law and our Islamic Sharia? There is a worldly effect and there is a spiritual effect. In many cases, both of those effects will be in harmony with one another. If we live a life that is pious and that is in accordance with the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we will only be eating those things that are healthy and pure for us. We will be abstaining from those things that are harmful and impure for us. We will be developing our schedule, our relationships, our goals in life, our budgeting of our time and our financial resources in a way that is beneficial for us in this life and also that is beneficial for us in the hereafter. But is there a one-to-one, 100% correspondence between our worldly interests and our spiritual interests? It is never going to be possible. So which is the priority in Islam? The priority is the hereafter. The priority is the spiritual. And the reason for that we have already talked about. That we believe that it is spiritual laws that are in charge of and above and that govern our worldly and our material existence. So in the final analysis, Allah wants us to live our lives as a means and as a vessel in order to achieve a certain spiritual result. So long as the two paths are in harmony, our worldly best interests and our eternal best interests will be together. If there is ever a tension or a conflict between the two, then as a believer, we are to prefer our spiritual and our eternal well-being and not our worldly or our spiritual well-being. Now, what is the confusion that we find many believers have? They are more concerned with the natural effects of actions than they are concerned with the spiritual effects and the relationship of our actions to our intentions. Let me give you one very common example. There are people who say that if I happen to eat something that is haram, then it is going to affect my soul. Meat that is not dhabiha, that is not slaughtered for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is meat that has certain differences from properly slaughtered dhabiha meat. On one level, there will be certain effects to that meat. We do believe that whether a person slaughters their meat properly or whether they do not slaughter their meat properly does have an actual effect on what the reality of that meat is. It's not just an obligation, it is not just a law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it does affect the actual reality of what it is that you are eating. But has Allah asked us to avoid all of those possible worldly effects of our meat or our food? Or has He given us a different standard that we are to apply? Just like the example of smoking, there are certain meats, there are certain foods that will have a certain effect on my health. Eating too much of a certain food may damage my health or it may benefit my health. And that will be without regard to whether I know what I am eating or I don't know what I'm eating. If I eat too much salt, even if I don't know that salt is bad for me, if I consume too much of it, it will harm me. If I eat a healthy diet, then that healthy diet will benefit me even if I don't know what I'm eating. If halal and dhabiha meat is different from non-dhabiha meat, will there be a difference in the worldly effect of that meat? Whether I know or don't know whether the meat is dhabiha, based on the logic that we have been pursuing, there will be a difference. So if I have meat in front of me, that meat is not slaughtered Islamically. If I do believe that improperly slaughtered meat is truly different than properly slaughtered meat, regardless of whether I know or whether I don't know, regardless of whether I am responsible or I am not responsible, will there be a different effect on my physical and certainly on my spiritual being from the two kinds of meat? Yes, because that meat is different. But does that mean that therefore I should avoid any possibility of consuming meat that might not have been slaughtered properly? No. Because not every effect is an effect that Allah has ordered us to be careful of. This is the mistake that many Muslims make. They say that dhabiha meat and non-dhabiha meat are two different things. And so when I go to a Muslim, I will ask them, where did you buy this meat? And then if I don't trust the store or the facility where they purchase the meat from, then I will go and I will ask them that, what kind of process do you have to buy your meat or to slaughter your meat? We will research, we will tell people that maybe what they are eating is questionable, and we will go out of our way to make life difficult for other people or for ourselves, because we are concerned about the outward effect of that meat or that food that we are consuming. But according to the logic that we have explained, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us that there is an effect. The more important effect is the spiritual effect that is rooted in your intention. And intention comes from knowing what is the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and having a spirit of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if Allah says that when I go to the house of my fellow Muslim, I am to trust their piety and their judgment, and I am to eat without questioning or interrogating them, then is it more beneficial to my spirit to eat the meat without knowing where it comes from? Or is it more beneficial to my spirit to say that I am going to avoid any possibility of eating non-dhabiha meat, and therefore I will question the person, interrogate the person, and maybe even embarrass them or make them regret having invited me in the first place? Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. I give this example because I know several cases where people have brought, for example, a snack or tabarruk to a masjid or to a majlis, and because of this process of interrogation, they have decided that they will not repeat that mistake again. Because the drink they brought, the snack they brought, the food they brought, they had to answer many different questions, and people would go around and question, ask, and wonder about whether that is correct or whether that is not correct. The solution is not to say that it doesn't make a difference. Yes, it does make a difference. Eating halal and dhabiha will have an effect on our body and it will have an effect on our soul. That is why Allah has made that law in the first place. But our job is to prioritize our spiritual outcome. And that depends entirely on our intention and on our obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And because our physical or our outwardly interests can never be entirely aligned with our spiritual interests, because the material interests are of a lower level and spiritual interests are of a higher level. When there is a conflict, we are to prefer the spiritual outcome over the material outcome. So even if there is a potential that we may have some minor material harm, then we are to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and follow the wisdom that He has given us, with the trust that there is a greater spiritual interest which may even show up in our material life that Allah knows about, that we don't know about, and that we might discover later on in our life, or if we don't discover it in this life, we will discover it in the hereafter. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. And related to that, there is one very important lesson that we want to learn from trying to understand the conduct and the sunan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the way that He governs our affairs. And this is, in a sense, the summary of all of the different topics that we have talked about until now. This is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will manage our affairs according to whatever type of system we want Him to manage our affairs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will govern our lives according to those principles that we admit and that we submit to. If you ever found a person say, that why is it that these people think that iman has such an effect? I have tried all of those things, and when I give sadaqah, I never had a case where 10 times that sadaqah came back to me. I made dua, and those periods in my life when I made dua, I didn't find that I was healthier, I was wealthier, I was more prosperous, I had more of my wishes and more of my goals being attained than those times when I was not prosperous. If you've ever had people express, or maybe in your own life you've had that question come, and the reason for that is that Allah has said that in a hadith of our 8th Imam, Imam Ali ibn Musa al-Ridha alayhi salatu wa salam, أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنِّ عَبْدِيَ الْمُؤْمِنْ بِي إِنْ خَيْرًا فَخَيْرًا وَإِنْ شَرًّا فَشَرًّا. That whatever my servant thinks of me, that is where I will be. If they think well of me, then I will treat them well. And if they think poorly of me, then I will treat them according to that logic which they themselves are willing to accept. Not because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a desire to harm us or to punish us, but because He wishes to guide us according to that receptivity that we ourselves show. So if I decide that I am going to live a material life, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will govern my affairs according to a material logic. And when He gives me wealth, or when He takes wealth away from me, there won't be a higher spiritual lesson that He wishes me to learn from what He is doing for me, because I am not receptive to that spiritual lesson or guidance. And if I believe that there is a spiritual realm that is higher than the material realm, and the material realm is in service of spiritual goals, then Allah will put me through very similar tests. A believer and an unbeliever may sometimes be in debt. A believer and an unbeliever may sometimes have abundance of material resources. A believer and an unbeliever may sometimes be sick. A believer and an unbeliever may sometimes be powerful and healthy and prosperous. But the difference is that because the unbeliever does not believe that there is a spiritual realm above the material realm, those different stages and those different tests within their life will not have the effect of bringing them onto the path of guidance. For a believer, all of those different stages will have the cause and the effect of bringing a person to appreciate that we don't govern all of our own affairs, and what comes to us is not because of what we have earned, but it is through the grace and the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore there is a hadith of our 6th Imam, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wa salam. He says that there is nothing that amazes me more then how Allah takes a believer from one stage in life to a different stage, from one test to another test, from one blessing to another blessing. He says that because Allah has determined that He is going to guide a believer through each stage and each different state in their life, if a believer were to be tortured by having their body torn to pieces limb by limb, then it would be in their best interest. And if a believer were given the kingdom of heaven and earth and made the ruler of the entire earth, then that would be for their best interest. In other words, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a believer plenty or abundance, He makes sure that He's not going to give that believer that blessing in such a way that they will become negligent or distracted and forget to worship Allah and obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If there is that danger, then Allah will first give them a hardship to remind them and then give them the blessing. And if a person is a believer and Allah is afraid that if I test them in this way, then that person will begin to wonder where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in His mercy and in His compassion, then Allah will back off that test in such a way that the believer's faith will be preserved. That is only for the believers. But for somebody who does not have that system, does not have that ideology, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not care about whether they are going to be guided or not be guided. Because even if He were to care, and even if He were to test them, when the blessing is going to possibly make them negligent, then they would not be able to achieve guidance. They would not be looking for it. They would simply maybe become more angry at Allah that they had a blessing and it was taken away from them. It's only a believer who, when they are tested by the removal of a blessing, will turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with istighfar, with penitence, and say, Allah, if we have become unworthy, then forgive us our sins and our shortcomings. And if an unbeliever is being tested and they are about to lose their faith, then Allah will not lessen that hardship in order to guide them. Because even if He lessens the hardship, then they might only say that, well, now that we are no longer in that extreme trouble, we have more time to be able to embark on our haram pleasures and those things that we were not able to do when we were in hardship. So it's again, not because Allah is withholding His favor, but because a person is going to either be receptive to certain wisdom or not be receptive to certain wisdom. So the lesson that we learn in summary from all of those different conducts and all of those principles that Allah uses to govern our affairs is that it depends on what ideology and what worldview we want to apply within our lives. If we say that, oh Allah, we are going to live with our life on a purely material accounting, we will give and we will demand from You on a material level, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not show us any karamat or any miracles or any blessings that will remove us from thinking that everyone's affairs are governed entirely by material planning and consideration. And if we believe that there is a blessing or a grace that comes based on intention and not based on outward actions, then to the extent that we open our heart to that possibility and we live a life of faith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show us how that faith and how that sincerity can bring us blessings that cannot be tasted on a material level. And that is why the basis of iman is love. Because to open up your heart and move beyond that which can be measured and that which can be quantified and that which can be examined and tested, it requires a person to have a love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To close our eyes and say that we will do this action not because we have calculated that it will be to our benefit, but because we trust that You as our Creator have our best interests at heart. Because of our love for You, we will do these actions and we will wait to see how You will bring those blessings to show themselves in our life. And that person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا, that we will show them our different paths. We will show them our outcomes that we have in store for the believers. There is a hadith of Imam Hussain alayhi salatu wa salam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
He says, "Nafisu fil khayrat." Compete with one another in those things that are good. وَلَا تَحْتَسِبُوا بِخَيْرٍ لَمْ تُعَجِّلُوا. Don't count a deed a good deed if you didn't rush to do it. Now, if I do a good deed after having thought about it and seen what other people are doing and wondering whether it's going to cause me some material harm, some material benefit, it might still be a good deed. It might still be fulfilling the obligation that I have. But if I have had to think about it, and if I have paused and hesitated, then it is not an action that is rooted and that is based in love. It is an action that is based in calculation. It might fulfill the minimum requirement of my obligation. But the Imam says that don't count it a good deed. لا تحتسبوا بخيرٍ لم تعجلوا. Because it's not going to bring you from a lower form of existence, a lower outcome to your life, to a higher outcome in your life. And what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be able to do is to live a wise life on material terms, but not live a life that is limited to those material terms. Hadith that I mentioned on Ashura yesterday, where Imam Ja'far as-Sadiq alayhi salatu wa salam, he says, "Kulluna sufunun najat, walakinna safinata al-Husayn asra," points to the same reality. The Imam says that all of us are ships of guidance, but the ship of Husayn is the fastest ship, because it is the ship of Husayn that most closely connects us to making decisions and to doing things in our life on the basis of love, on the basis of a connection and a devotion, and not on the basis of material calculation. None of those calculations that we will do as a believer will ever take us away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it is those actions that we do on the basis of devotion, on the basis of love, on the basis of trust, on the basis of faith that the path of Ahlul Bayt is the best path, even where we don't understand it. It is those actions that are going to raise us the quickest from a material existence to a spiritual existence.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
And it is for this reason that whenever we have times of happiness or we have times of sadness in our personal lives or in our religious lives, it is to our benefit to remember Imam Hussain alayhi salatu wa salam. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. And the events that took place during his life and the sacrifices that he and his followers and his companions gave at the end of their life. That is, for us to move beyond the outward aspect of Sharia, for us to move beyond just those things that we can fathom and we can understand with our intellect, and to connect to our religion, to connect to our values at the level of the soul and at the level of the heart. When we look at many of the decisions that were made by the martyrs of Karbala, they were fuqaha. They were the most intellectually prepared, wise, learned members of the Muslim Ummah. And it was the emphasis of the Imams to say that they were not blind followers, and they did not have blind faith, or they did not have blind love. Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salatu wassalam, he says that his uncle Abbas was a faqih and not just a ghazi or a warrior. Imam Hussein himself says that Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. That Habib ibn Mudahir was a faqih and not just a warrior. That emphasis that these martyrs were fuqaha, were ulama, were knowledgeable, were wise, were aware, is to say that that process of devotion and love is not in contradiction or in competition with learning and with wisdom, with hikmah and with fiqh and with ilm. But it is a process that comes through our fiqh, through our ilm, through our learning. We realize the limitations of our calculations. We realize the limitations of our learning. We realize the limitations of our understanding. And we say there comes a time when we are to trust. There comes a time when we are to follow in the footsteps of those who are greater than us and those who are ma'soom, because they will lead us to heights that no planning can take us to. And that is the journey of Karbala. And so when we ask Imam Hussein what it is, Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad, that we can do, he gives us that answer. He says, سارعوا في الخيرات ونافسوا في المكارم ولا تحتسبوا بخير لم تعجلوا. Do those things that are good. You know they are good based on your ilm, based on your fiqh, based on your study, based on your knowledge of sharia. But when you want to become a Husseini, when you want to connect yourself to that safina of Hussein and that ship of Hussein, then do it not on the basis of calculation, but do it on the basis of love. Do it as soon as you hear about it, before you have a time to think about it, before you have a time to listen to the whispering of shaitan, who might say that, are you tired? Is this the time? Is this not the time? And if you live your life on the basis of that acting on top, on the basis of love, then you will develop an affinity for Imam Hussein. And the martyrs, that was what brought them to the path of Karbala. Listen to the challenges that they had and the different struggles they had and how they overcame those struggles. Habib and Muslim, whom we mentioned, the city of Kufa was in siege and Karbala was in siege. They broke through the siege of Kufa and they broke through the siege of Karbala. And they came to Imam Hussein and they said that your soldiers are ready for you. They were scholars of Islam. They were teachers of the Quran. They were hafaz of the Quran. But what brought them and allowed them to be able to escape the spies of Ibn Ziyad in Kufa and the spies of Umar ibn Sa'd in Karbala was that love and that devotion that opened up the paths and that allowed them to find a way. لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. And they came to Imam Hussein and they said that here we are to serve you. There were children, there were elderly, there were weak, there were strong, but all of them were ready to serve. And what gave them strength and what gave them inspiration was that love that they had for Islam and that love that they had for Imam Hussein. And if we look and we see the stories that are told in books of Maqtal about how they fought, then you can see what it is to fight on the basis of love compared to fight on the basis of material strength. Not one of the soldiers who fought for the Imam was defeated without having first killed many of the enemy soldiers. Even the children, even Aun and Muhammad, even Ali Akbar, even Qasim, when they faced the enemy, faced their enemy in victory, and not one of them was able to be defeated in single combat. Was Qasim an expert soldier? Did he fight on the basis of training or on the basis of physical strength? Or did Humayd ibn Muslim say that he was able to make the enemy flee before him because from his body and from his spirit there was a devotion and a love and a sincerity that was able to vanquish the enemies even on the physical plane of their existence. And so he was only able to be defeated when he was surrounded from all sides. These were the army of Hussein. These were the martyrs that were given by Imam Hussein. These were the soldiers that Lady Zainab gave in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine how difficult it was for Lady Zainab to mourn such soldiers. After Ashura, now it is a time of trial. Now it is a time of grief. When Ashura had passed and night fell, it was with difficulty, as you heard yesterday, it was with difficulty that Lady Zainab prepared all of the children and all of the women to spend a night under the sky without shelter and without protection. No longer was Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas guarding the tents. No longer was Imam Hussein going from one area to another to make sure that there was no enemy soldier who might attack unaware. It was only Lady Zainab who was offering consolation, who was dressing wounds, who was providing support to those who were grieving. And as she would go from one place to another place to bring the children back to their gathering place, to bring the women back to where they were to spend that night, she would pass by the bodies of the martyrs and she would see their bodies lying unburied on the sands of Karbala. If it was difficult for Lady Zainab to see the body of Qasim on the day of Ashura, imagine how much more difficult it was for her to pass that wounded body on Sham-e Ghariban, when there was not one body that was coming, but there were all of those martyred bodies. And as she could see that the enemy had already begun giving a full honorable burial to each of the wounded and each of the killed enemy, their bodies were given the burial of an honorable soldier. And the honorable soldiers of Ahlul Bayt, they lay on the sands of Karbala. The dawn of the 11th of Muharram came, and Lady Zainab brought that news to each and every members of the caravan that preparations are to be made to leave Karbala. The first mourning took place on the morning of the 11th of Muharram. When the women gathered, the children gathered, they surrounded those bodies, and they said that if we were given the opportunity by these enemy soldiers who are behind us, then we would never leave Karbala until we had given an honorable burial to each of these martyred soldiers. But we have enemies who are standing guard and are preventing us from moving towards the maqtal. We pay our respects and we promise that if we are ever able to be freed from captivity, if we ever acquire our freedom, then the first place that we will come in all of the world is that we will return to Karbala. And if now we are not able to mourn as we would like to mourn, then we will return to Karbala and we will mourn to our heart's content. The captives were prepared, their hands were bound, their feet were bound. According to narrations, there was a rope that was placed through the necks of the women and the children. Adults and children were bound by a single rope that had knots in it, so that whenever the caravan would proceed, Lady Zainab and Umm Kulthum, they would lower their necks so that it would not cause any difficulty to the children who had a smaller height than the adults. And Lady Zainab would sometimes say that, "Oh, Naam Zain al-Abideen, cast down your eyes, because I see before me the head of my brother Hussein, and I know that if you see this sight, then you will not be able to bear it. At one time, Shimon said that the captives are to be returned to Karbala, and they are to be made to go once more before the bodies where they lay on the ground. I want them to see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done. And it is said that at that time, all of the women, they threw themselves from the camels, and they found their martyrs on the ground, and they began to mourn, until Umar ibn Sa'd said that now we will mount you, and we promise that we will not take you before the martyrs. And then the caravan began to proceed towards Kufa. At that moment in the city of Kufa, there was one loyal servant of Ahlul Bayt by the name of Abdullah al-Azdi. He said that, O Ibn Ziyad, you are a liar, and your commander who appointed you as a governor are a traitor to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Umar ibn Ziyad gave the command that Abdullah al-Azdi is to be arrested, and hundreds of soldiers from the tribe of Azd, they came out with their swords. They said, Ubaydullah, you will not arrest a member of our tribe who spent his days in worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his nights in prayer. But there was nobody to say to Ibn Ziyad, there was nobody to say to Umar ibn Sa'd, that those captives who were on their way to Karbala, they also used to spend their days in salat and their nights in recitation of Quran. The captives came from Karbala to Kufa in one day, and they were placed in a dark dungeon while the city of Kufa was decorated to celebrate the victory and the triumph of Yazid over the family of the Prophet and the progeny of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un.